When you think of parents today, which generation do you picture? And how are current parents parenting differently to those of the past? My name is Holly Schaaf, and today I'm going to be the host of today's episode to allow Ashley Fell, McCrindle's Director of Advisory, and our usual The Future Report podcast host to jump into the guest seat again to talk about this topic and offer some valuable insights. So Ash, welcome back to the podcast today as a guest.
Thank you, Holly. It's always a delight to mix it up and jump into the guest seat and have you as the host. So thanks for stepping in as well.
Absolutely, Ash. We are delighted to have you on again as a guest and offer some insights here on a really interesting topic, exploring a little bit around millennial and Gen Z parenting and some of the different insights there. So let's kick off with question one. Ash, children today are a mix of Generation Z and Generation Alpha. Who are the parents of these generations?
That's exactly right. Generation Z and Generation Alpha are the children of today. And if we take generations to span 15 years, which we do at McCrindle and we firmly believe in, that means that children of today are a mix mostly of, as we mentioned, Generation Alpha, who describes those aged 14 and under, and Generation Z, who are aged 15 to 29. And a note on Gen Z, which I think is quite an interesting cohort at the moment, because the youngest of this generation are in their mid-teens, so they're going through puberty and all the roller coasters of what that entails. Yes. And then the oldest of this generation are about to hit 30 next year. So at this point in time in 2024, anyone who is in their 20s is a Gen Z, which will change next year because the oldest of them will start to hit 30. But I think it's an interesting point in time where you've got the younger kids in high school and going through all of that, and then you've got older Gen Zs who in some cases may be parents already. So you've got this interesting kind of youngest and oldest point in this generation. So they're in a few different life stages. And typically, because generations span 15 years, we say that a generation of, I guess a generation parents the generation that isn't directly after them, but the one that's kind of two generations after them. Mm. So the generations we have in our world today are the builders and the baby boomers at the oldest end. Then we have Gen X, then the millennials, then Gen Z, followed by Generation Alpha. And this would be a lot easier with a graphic to display this, but basically you've got the baby boomers parenting the millennials. You've got Generation X who parents Gen Z, and then you've got the millennials today, this new generation of kind of parents parenting Generation Alpha, because every generation kind of skips the one below them and parents the one kind of two after, if that makes sense. And when we think about the immediate future, Generation Z, who I've mentioned are 15 to 29 today, will parent Generation Beta effectively, the ones to come after Alpha, who will begin being born next year from 2025 to 2039. So that's kind of a general rule, but if you're on the cusp, this may not be the case. So as an example, I am a millennial. I'm in my early 30s, so I'm at the younger end of the millennials as a generation, and I don't have children yet. So if I have them in the coming years, I will be a millennial parent of Gen Beta, if that makes sense. So I guess it would have been maybe somewhat poetic for me to have had some Gen Alpha children because I did write a book about them. Yeah. But alas, maybe my future children will be happy that that wasn't the case. But it's not, I guess that the point of that is it's not always as cut and dry as each generation parenting the one that is two below them. But it is the best way, I think, that we can talk about it in a quick and easy way in terms of which generation is typically parenting which other sort of generation.
Yeah. Thanks for that overview, Ash. It was very clear, despite I know you mentioning sometimes at the graph, and we have our graphic, we have a few of those on our website as well, if you wanted to go in and access those resources to see the different generations and kind of have that laid out for you there. But appreciate that oversight and making that, making that note as well, that not every single generation, all millennials are going to, you know, parent Generation Alpha if they have children, and making that differentiation. And I think it's even just funny to note as well, I think we had talked in a previous podcast episode, Luke Davies, one of our colleagues, colleagues and we were talking on Generation Z had noted, I'm just like so surprised about how old Generation Z has gotten, but I think people still very much view Generation Z as being the young generation, but to talk about them now being the parents and the parents of Generation Beta, who are now starting to be born next year, it's just really crazy to think about time going by like that and generations moving along. But in that, big topic of today is we're looking at parenting these different generations, and what are some of the ways that parents today are different to parents of the past and of past generations?
I think the first obvious kind of difference to me is that parents today are older than previous generations. So demographically, we are, I guess, pushing back the traditional life markers of getting married and having children. And one of the slides we use in our presentations, and one that I really like to convey this, is to look at kind of the new median age of marriage and the median age for a mother at the birth of her first child. So back in the 1980s and 1987, so quite a few decades ago now, females were getting married at the median age of 25.2 and males at 27.6. So typically people getting married back in the 80s at kind of the mid to late 20s. Today that's been pushed back about 5 years. So the median age of marriage for a woman today is 30.5. So on the way to 31, and for males it's 32.4. So we're delaying getting married, and we're also delaying having children. So back in the 1980s, the median age for a mother at the birth of her first child was 26.8, and today it's 31.4. So we've got this, delaying of traditional life markers and having children later in life. The other interesting thing, I think, demographically speaking, is that women today are actually having less children. So the total fertility rate is declining, which means people are having less children. And there's been some talk about this in the media recently in Australia, and that the fact that Australia is in what people have called it a baby recession. So the number of births in Australia dropped to about 289,100 in 2023, which sounds like a lot of births, but typically over the last few decades, we've been at the 300,000 or more mark, and that's the lowest recorded number of births since 2006. So we haven't seen such a sharp drop in births in Australia since the 1970s, which coincided with the initial widespread adoption of the contraceptive pill. So it's an interesting time, and a lot of people spoke about the COVID baby boom, but we seem to have kind of come out of that now. And I think a lot of people cite economic conditions, such as cost of living pressures and economic uncertainty, as well as financial insecurity, as contributing reasons as to why people are postponing the child rearing stage, and if and when they do, they are having less children. But I think also there's a social change aspect to this. The role of women in society over many, many years has evolved and changed, and women today are more educated than they ever have been before. We have jobs and careers and aspirations that go beyond child rearing. And I think that there also needs to be more consideration about parental leave and childcare and other areas for women to kind of give all of this up in this kind of economic climate that we're in, and kind of take on that career skip that happens when women exit the workforce to have children. So it's quite a different social and economic landscape than it was, you know, even 3 or 4 decades ago. But then, of course, even more so kind of when we go back hundreds of years ago and we think about the role of women and education levels and aspirations and things like that. The other aspect I have seen, especially online, is that so many women aren't sure if they want kids. And I think it was just this assumed kind of gender role and aspiration. And I think when, like, the millennials and Gen Zs, when we were young, it was just assumed that we would at some point. But as that point draws closer, many women aren't feeling ready to make the many sacrifices that come with having children. And I was looking up some insights online about this, and I came across an article from the Washington Post, which I found it quite summarizing of everything I've just said. So I thought I'd read it because it's quite well addressed as well, I think, in this. So the article says, addressing declining fertility will require more creative thought about how to preserve women's economic gains in the workforce while also affording them flexibility to start families if they desire to do so. It is no surprise that young men without children, so I kind of had to read this again. It said, it is no surprise that young men without children are more likely than young women to report that they want to be parents someday because women bear the physical cost of childbirth and face greater career interruptions from parenthood than men do. We need to make it easier to have and raise children. One of the silver linings of the pandemic was that it expedited the shift toward more flexibility to work from home or have different hours that can help ease the transition to parenthood. Truly affordable and high quality childcare will do the same and has the potential to be much more meaningful than one-time bonuses for new parents that quickly run out. Making fertility treatments more broadly available is also crucial. And the article kind of went on to say, I want this to be better for Gen Z. My partner and I are lucky to be able to invest heavily in childcare, including by relying on help from two sets of grandparents who are young, healthy, and excited to assist. He and I are fortunate to have this as an option, and ironically, by virtue of our own choices to wait to start a family, it's one we won't be as well equipped to afford our own children. Mm. So there's a lot in that answer, and I think it's kind of shows the complexity around why we're having less children. There's economic factors, there's social factors, there's just societal change that's gone on. And it's interesting because I know it's been quite a big topic of conversation in Australia with regards to that birth rate falling. And for the economy at large, we need to have people in it we need workers. And it's a very kind of crude way of looking at it. But yeah, there's kind of a lot of, I think, policies or politicians or economists trying to work out how do we incentivize people to have kids. We need more families, more children, more parents, but it's not a straightforward kind of conversation anymore. And absolutely, let alone the fact that a lot of people are scared about the future and what kind of world children are being born into. So yeah, there's a lot that goes into it, maybe more of a complex conversation than in the past. However, I'm also aware that I am right smack bang in this life stage, and maybe I'd speak to older people who say we were still scared and it was still an economic kind of challenge. It's kind of interesting to speak to older people, and it's not to say that the decision to have a child or not is not a complex one, because I think it probably always has been. But when we think about the current context, it's interesting to think about those different aspects and how it impacts people's children parents' decision or people's decision to become parents, have children, but then also how they kind of raise those children and how it's differed across the generations.
Fascinating insights there, and it even just makes me reflect on my own life and circles, because I'm on the older end of Gen Z, so very much in what you're talking about there in terms of it being the time for a lot of people to start considering having children. I almost feel like coming out of the, and maybe this is just the people in my world, but marriage, kind of even like marriage side of things, now people are kind of transitioning a bit more into having children. And it's been very fascinating to observe, even across my friends and in my communities, the amount of people that I have spoken to who have only recently made that decision that they're at least not going to try or aren't interested in trying soon to have children. I feel like it's often a conversation that I'm actually a part of these days. And it does make me reflect, even with my generation, Gen Z, being so integrated online as well and on platforms like TikTok and social media and these platforms, that there's so much information and resource and articles and content out there on these sort of topics in particular. Just the impact that sort of conversation happening, even, in other countries and people having commentary on it, how much that can actually impact your own view and perception and choices. And there's obviously so many factors that go into that, but I've definitely seen videos come up on my For You page that have to do with this topic, and people offering differing maybe alternative views or opinions to what you might have once held, and reasons that they might be holding that opinion, and you might be swayed in a particular way because of that. And so it's just very fascinating to kind of consider that online presence with the younger generations and how these online opinions might actually be contributing to that. But fascinating, like you mentioned as well, there's so many external social economic factors. These sort of decisions don't happen in a vacuum to have children. There's so many things that contribute into that. So I feel like we could delve this podcast, another one just into that alone. Even that article you read, really fascinating there. But in terms of what we're talking about today as well, how do you feel that parenting styles, because of course, like you highlighted, there's different generations and different generations with different characteristics of what they kind of show. And, of course, when we talk about generational analysis, we obviously make the note as well that it isn't, the stereotyping, not to just accept it as it is, that there are nuances, and also not every single person fits fits perfectly within these. But in terms of parenting styles, looking at the trends as a whole, how do you see that parents today are actually parenting differently to those of the past in terms of their style of parenting?
It's been an interesting question. And I remember having to address this in the Generation Alpha book. And I think it's like anything, we want it to be at McCrindle, you know, easy to explain and easy for people to comprehend. But I think there's so many different parenting styles, and I found it difficult to be like, this generation uses this style and this generation uses this style. It's kind of like there are nuances there to explore. And I think one of those contextual factors, like you just mentioned, Holly, is the kind of community within which parents are parenting today. And the online community is huge for this generation of, you know, new parents in the millennials and Gen Z. And I think, like anything with technology, that has afforded them so many incredible benefits around. I've heard the stories of, you know, mums up at 3 a.m. breastfeeding, and they connect online on Facebook with all the other mums who are up breastfeeding. And it's like, oh, it's the technology and social media used for wholesome purposes and connection and community. And we can, you know, have, you know, literally any access to any piece of information and story, encouraging or challenging on the planet. And that's at times really good, and at times I think also challenging, because there's just so many more voices that influence people, and there are people who aren't experts coming on and sharing about parenting advice and tips with newborns. And so I've seen in the research we've done that even just how they're parenting with regards to social media and online communities is one, I think, way that it differs to those of the past. But in terms of actual parenting styles, I guess like any generalization, it's not necessarily true of every single person in that generation. But typically speaking, I think in the past, we have seen a lot more parents focus on discipline. Whereas I think the last few decades, we've seen a shift towards more accepting and nurturing parenting styles. And even the phrase I've been seeing online is gentler parenting.
Sure.
And it's interesting. I think parents today have, I guess, in general, it seems to me, departed from a one-size-fits-all approach to parenting. And so along with changing gender roles, we've seen changes in the expectations of even mums and dads in their parental responsibilities. You know, for example, while most baby boomers probably were shaped in households where fewer mums worked outside the home, today the majority of the parents of Generation Alpha are two-income earning. And along with this massive increase in the proportion of mums working full-time, expectations towards fathers have also changed, as many have become more actively involved in child rearing. And so that can be from attendance at parent-teacher nights and class concerts to school drop-offs and pickups and taking parental leave. There are kind of new expectations, I think, on dads and new behaviours coming through in this next generation. I think the other difference we've seen is also the increase in news coverage of issues around child harm and abuse. And I think that has led to an increased focus on safety. And the term that often we hear about this is helicopter parenting, which again, we've looked at this in different context. Like, I think every generation's had these tensions of wanting to keep their child safe and protect them, but also that tension of needing to let them explore and fail and hurt themselves so that they learn. And, you know, we've seen that in the research as well, that dads typically are quite good at letting kids go on skateboards and do things that mums are a bit more like, no, like, we don't want to, we need to protect them and secure them. And that's the role of a parent, but it's also at different stages time to let kids explore and pursue and fail and learn. So there's, I think, always been those kinds of challenges. But even the online world, how parents navigate that, it's a very different context to what, say, the baby boomers had. So I think all that is to say, while every generation has a mix of parenting styles, traditionally parents of, say, the baby boomers tended to use a more authoritarian style. And then we kind of saw the pendulum swing the other way to the more permissive approach, maybe, for parents of Gen Y. And I think what we're seeing now today is Gen Y themselves and even Gen Z become parents is probably a more balanced approach, where mums and dads are showing love and affection for their children, both verbally and physically, and a bit more involved as traditional gender roles have changed, as both parents have had to work. So again, this kind of convergence of social trends, economic, that kind of have a big impact on how we live and also how we're parenting.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, so interesting. And it really does make me think as well, and you had touched on it a bit there, but just even in terms of how much the upbringing of a particular generation and the different, you know, external factors that helped shape them and characteristics that they've perhaps developed or priorities they've developed, and how that does naturally get passed on to the children in terms of the things that they, you know, prioritize, whether that's in life or in family and all of that sort of thing, and how even like you mentioned there, like media being such a prominent part, especially as of late in terms of what's being communicated there, that those younger generations that, like, say, for example, like you're mentioning the younger side of millennial and me being on the older side of Gen Z, the engagement with social media and having access to all of that sort of content, how that might impact the way that you are going to and planning to parent your children. And it also makes me ponder as well, because technology was such starting to integrate into normal life a lot more so when I was younger and growing up. I remember having the first iPod and, you know, using that, and it had this little snake game, and that was the only thing that you could play on there, and just like a few different of those more kind of technologies when they were in their early formative sort of stages and things. But just how, with because of how much more advanced technology has even gotten since then, in terms of iPhones, iPads, you know, laptops, and then there being such prominent social platforms on there that younger generations are engaging with, even the pressure perhaps changes in parents how they are to engage with technology. And I know this is something that we talk about as well, but because there's, you know, so many younger people on platforms like TikTok, for example, that it does add an extra layer of challenge with the fact that it is, you know, if all the kids are on it, they would say, and that sort of thing of kind of managing, I guess, sort of that change in technology and online social platform, and how that's so different than previous generations who might not have had to deal with that same, I guess, sort of topic in that context as well. It's just interesting to consider. But I guess on that as well, as we're kind of wrapping up here, some very interesting insights from you, Ash, and lots to think about. But do you have any predictions about Gen Z and how they'll parent Gen Beta in the future?
Yeah, it's early days because we don't have any Gen Betas yet, yeah. But we actually have some Gen Z parents. And so what we did actually was conduct a study of parents in Australia a couple of months ago. And we kind of segmented the parents. So we said, do you have children under 18? Mm. That was kind of the qualifying question. And then we were able to segment those who were millennial parents compared to those who were Gen Z parents. Now, the Gen Z parents sample out of that 2,000 people survey was, as you would expect, a little bit smaller than the Gen Y or the millennial parents, because people are having children later in life and the oldest Gen Zs are only 29. So there's not a lot of parents in this generation yet, but there are some. And so we kind of used that to kind of explore whether there were many differences between millennials and Gen Z. And there were. They weren't super stark differences. Sometimes the research shows really interesting insights across the generations. And I think as more and more Generation Z parents come into existence, and we'll be able to kind of track that and see how they differ as their parenting experience becomes a little bit more of an experience. But I think what some of the findings we did kind of draw out of this study was firstly adaptability in parenting tools. So it seems like there's been a preference for flexibility and adaptability in the types of parenting tools that Gen Z parents are using. And it was interesting because what we were talking about in this study and what we saw was that there's kind of an inclination among this generation to switch between an outsourcing approach and a hands-on one, for example. So we see, as an example, an increase among parents engaging in childcare, which is outsourcing, as well as an increase in homeschooling, which is more of a hands-on approach. So it's kind of this dichotomy of trends, and I think it shows just this flexible attitude, which makes sense because Gen Z are a very flexible generation. They've grown up in very flexible times with pandemics and changes to work. And so I think that flexibility and adaptability is the first kind of observation we made. The second is a focus on individuality and emotional intelligence. And I think this is another hallmark of Gen Z as a generation, and therefore their parenting, because this generation does have a heightened emphasis, I think, on fostering individuality and emotional intelligence. And I think we can expect this new generation of parents to prioritize things like open communication, empathy, self-expression, diversity, encouraging their children to explore their emotions freely. And this, I guess, is a slight contrast with Generation Y, especially the older cohort of Generation Y parents who probably adopted a bit more of a structured and directive approach, which we often associate with older millennial parents. And I think the other aspect of this is that Gen Z have grown up alongside an increased awareness of mental health issues, and I think therefore place a strong emphasis on emotional intelligence and communication. And as a result of that, we do expect that they will actively, as a generation of parents, will actively create spaces for their children to express their emotions and develop coping mechanisms for the challenges they might face. And this came through in the study where 40% of Gen Z parents said they were likely to always consider their child's preferences when they make plans for the family. Right. So that 40% of Gen Z was slightly above the 32% of millennial parents who said the same. So not a huge difference in percentage, but still one to note.
Yeah.
And so I think the shift is that over time, children have, I guess, been viewed as little people to be understood and guided. That seems to be the evolution rather than kind of blank slates to be prescribed and directed. And I think as parents, Gen Z will integrate more holistic and balanced approaches to family life, ensuring that their children not only have the tools to express their emotions, but also understand the importance of maintaining overall well-being. And this could kind of manifest in things like family activities, shared responsibilities, and a focus on creating and nurturing home environment. So that's kind of the second one. And the third one, which I found quite interesting, and I think it relates to what you were just saying before, Holly, is that Gen Z are, I think maybe even more so than millennials, acknowledging that technology is a double-edged sword. And so over the last couple of decades, of course, we've seen that technology plays a dual role in modern day parenting. On the one hand, we've seen parents, notably millennials, I would say millennial parents, leverage technology as a tool for education, connection, entertainment. They've integrated it seamlessly into their children's lives from a young age. On the other hand, there's also a cautious awareness of the potential pitfalls of technology, and parents want to promote balance with regards to screen time and outdoor activities and interpersonal interactions. But what I think is interesting, even say the difference between millennials and Gen Z, or even you and I, Holly, at not even that many years between us. But like you mentioned, Gen Z were really shaped by technology and social media and devices in a much more integrated way than millennials were when they were young. And so I think because of that, what we've seen is Gen Z probably be a bit more aware of the downfalls and the negatives. Now, that's not to say that they won't use technology in their parenting. I think they will. But when we reflect on the context that shaped millennials, I think we'll do well to note that they were the first generation to experience social media as parents. So it kind of exploded as this, as my generation began parenting. Whereas for Gen Z, social media has really been used in their formative years.
Yeah.
And so now we've had it for a decade and a half, basically all of Generation Alpha's life so far. We know more about it, about the positives and the downsides. And I think so while many millennial parents use social media to document their children's lives, Gen Z know more about both the positives and the challenges that come with social media use from a young age. And in this study we did, Gen Z parents were more likely to strongly agree that limiting their child's screen time is a high priority for them. So that was 36% of Gen Z compared to 30% of older millennial parents. So as the most technologically savvy generation of parents, I think Gen Z will see the benefits of technology and screen time, but equally they see the downsides of it and are pushing back on technology and the age at which their children access and engage with it because they've kind of experienced more of the downsides. And one story that I had recently at a conference, I was talking to some people after the keynote that I gave, and we were talking about technology and Gen Alpha, and this person's reflection, I'm pretty sure they were a parent themselves, their reflection was that the shift they expect to see is the pendulum swing back the other way. And you know, for millennials who have kind of been quite, in many cases, prolific with sharing their children's lives online and Gen Alpha, we might see the pendulum swing back for Gen Z, who might put up some more boundaries. And
absolutely.
Yeah, so it's all, not all speculation, because we do have some Gen Z parents, but I think we will see as more of this generation do have children themselves, what kind of parenting styles they choose, how they choose themselves to engage with technology and social media as parents, but also how they kind of let and guide their children use it as well.
Yeah, so interesting and helpful for even me as a Gen Z who will hopefully be a parent in the future. And just really fascinating, even with that last point there of what you were talking about in terms of the pendulum swinging back, I I mean, even just from what I see and engage with online, I absolutely see that to be true. Even just in terms of some of the Gen Z influencers I follow are parents, and definitely put a large emphasis on not having their children either involved, actually not even showing their young children on the mm-hmm. internet, not having them be a part of the content. Whereas I guess, yeah, like you mentioned mm-hmm. with previous generations, that might have not been as much the case. But also even a note that connects into what we were talking about before in terms of parenting and the community there that can be online as well. It was interesting that I saw one of the Gen Z parents who I follow, who doesn't really engage with or have her children be kind of engaging in this platform that she has. She has quite a large platform on there, but even makes the comment about how it's so easy for her, and maybe this is even part of that Gen Z really having social media be a formative part of this girl's upbringing, for example, where she recognizes the pros and cons of social media and maybe even this authenticity that Gen Z strive for and want as well, is she had said, I actually really have trouble comparing myself to other mothers online, where I see mm-hmm. other people and I see their lives and I see how they, you know, what they're doing with their children. They're able to work this full job and they're able to do all these things. And I'm thinking, I'm so tired. I can't even get up and do the things I need to do. How are you doing that? And she actually made a whole video that I was watching the other day, making the point of this one particular other influencer who, you know, does all of these extravagant things on her page and has these multiple young children. She said that she was consistently comparing herself to this one particular influencer, but then had the realization that she's like, oh yeah, she probably outsources help. She probably has someone who comes in to help, you know, take care of the children while she's off doing this particular niche that she does within her influencing. You know, like, there's so many things that mm-hmm. happen behind the scenes of these videos and of this content, but it can be so easy to go on and just compare yourself. And so that even just makes me think, because I guess, yeah, like you mentioned, there's not this massive pool of Gen Z parents that we can pull from and kind of see these insights play out. But I would say this my reflection is, even in this one particular influencer and online personality, what you're saying is definitely true in terms of both not having the children engaged, but then also the pros and cons of being online as a parent and having those other parents to potentially compare yourself to. And yeah, kind of always have that point of tension there, but how she wants to use her platform to bring that to light and help other people who might be in the same situation as well. That also feels quite well within the Gen Z, almost authenticity within social media a little bit as well, which is just interesting to see. But so many interesting insights here, Ash. Thank you so, so much for coming on. It was so valuable to be able to hear, just some of these insights and your reflections there. And I really appreciate the chat today.
My pleasure, Hol. Thanks for jumping into the host seat that you do so well as well.
Thanks, Ash. Always happy to be here. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.